In 2011, Johnny Knox suffered one of the worst injuries in NFL history when his spine was folded backwards on this play. Welcome back, everybody. I'm Dr. Brian Sutterer, and this is your number one source for learning about the unique medical side of the world of sports. In this video, we're going to break down one of the most requested videos I've gotten on this channel, Johnny Knox's back injury. As usual, please consider subscribing if you enjoy learning about this unique side of sports, and be sure and follow me over on Twitter for more real-time updates and analysis, and let's get started. This was the play in 2011 where Johnny Knox got hurt. He's trying to recover this fumble here, and as he dives forward trying to get the ball up off the ground, we see the Seattle defender come in and basically force Knox's back into a severe amount of hyperextension where his back is almost completely folded up and touching his lower back. Knox suffered a fractured dislocation of a region of his spine called the thoracolumbar junction and required a fusion surgery to correct the fracture, but also suffered some nerve damage. A number of unfortunate factors led to Knox being in this position where he suffered this fracture. The first is we can see him diving onto the ball here. He's falling down towards the ground, and all of his momentum is carrying him down towards the field. As he lands, the lower part of his body, his knees and his legs, make contact with the field, but his upper body is still free to move. Essentially, we've got a rigid point of contact down with the grass, but we've got a free open end of the upper body able to move. And so then when the defender comes in and hits him, basically there's no choice but for his body to fold at the point where that contact goes from being on the field to up in the air, which in his case was his lower back. Knox also got hit more from the side, which added an additional lateral bending component to his injury and probably in part contributed to the fracture. Here we can see the Seattle defender coming in to hit him. And again, Knox's lower body here has just made contact with the ground, but his upper body is still free to bend and take that hit. And so the defender comes in a little bit from the side, and we can see it wasn't just pure hyperextension, but also Knox's body had a component of some lateral bending from being hit off to the side. Now, of course, this is a very excessive amount of hyperextension. And when we go to our anatomy model, we'll see why that results in this fracture and injury. Before we do that though, I want to give a quick shout out to the sponsor of this video. If you're searching for your next pair of frames, then look no further than the sponsor of today's video, GlassesUSA.com. By cutting out the middleman, GlassesUSA.com offers prescription glasses for up to 70% off retail price. Now you can shop for prescription eyewear online at affordable prices without leaving your home. GlassesUSA.com offers over 4,000 styles of eyeglasses and sunglasses, including in-house brands like Muse and Amelia E, and designer brands like Ray-Ban, Oakley, Armani, Gucci, and many more. You can find every conceivable style and color you want, even specialty glasses like sports glasses, safety glasses, and even kids' glasses. I wear glasses especially at night when I'm working on the computer for a long period of time, and especially while driving, and I've been super happy with these frames I got from GlassesUSA.com. They have an amazing virtual try-on tool where you can simply upload a photo, make some adjustments to the location of your eyes, and then just like that, you can virtually try on any of their pairs of glasses. You can easily add your prescription with their free prescription scanner app to make sure you get exactly the lenses that you need. Your glasses will arrive right to your doorstep with standard shipping free on all orders, and you have 14 days to return them for a full refund, product exchange, or store credit. 100% no questions asked, no hassle guarantee. So head down to the link in the description below to get your next pair of complete frames starting at just $30. Make buying that new pair of glasses much less stressful. Huge thank you to GlassesUSA.com for sponsoring this video, and let's get back to our learning. Here we have the anatomical representation of our spine. And what I've done here is I've color-coded the different vertebral bodies corresponding with the different segments or regions of our spine. Up top here in blue, we have our 7 cervical vertebrae. Down below that in green, we have our 12 thoracic vertebrae. And then finally down below that in the pink here, we have our 5 lumbar vertebrae. And then of course we have our sacrum down below, and then our tailbone even further. The natural biomechanics, the curve of the spine, and the shape of the individual joints are what sort of sets up the spine to be injured in this type of a pattern that Knox suffered. First off, you can see as we work our way down the spine that we have a bit of a natural curvature. This sort of C-shaped curve up in the cervical spine is called a lordosis. Down then in our thoracic spine, we have more of a hump, which is a kyphosis, which transitions back to a lordosis down in the lumbar spine. So we get this natural S-shaped sort of curve that gives our spine its normal biomechanical properties. Different regions of the spine have different mobility compared to one another in terms of flexion, so bending forward, or extension, bending backwards. When you bend forward to touch your toes, we call that lumbar flexion. And when you bend backwards at the waist, that's lumbar extension. So for Knox here, this is extension. He's bent backwards as opposed to if he were bent forward at the waist, that would be flexion. Now, the most common place on the spine that we see fractures are gonna be in an area called the thoracolumbar junction. It's this region of the spine where we transition from the thoracic vertebrae down to the lumbar vertebrae. So this is right around the region where we see that inflection point or that bending when we look back here at Johnny Knox's spine. Basically, we're holding this part pretty stable down below and taking everything up above and bending it backwards. So as you bend it backwards, you're gonna get excessive compression on these posterior elements in the back of the spine. You're gonna get tearing of these ligaments here in the front, and that's gonna cause that fracture, and then it goes even further, the dislocation. Biomechanically, this is a weak spot of the spine. If we look above that junction, we have the thoracic spine, and the thoracic spine naturally has a good amount of rotation, meaning turning from one side to the other. But our thoracic spine, especially in the middle portion where the ribs are coming off, doesn't have as much flexion or extension. A lot of the flexion and extension is gonna come from the segments of our lower back, and so you basically end up with this transition zone between limited amounts of flexion and extension in the thoracic spine to then higher amounts of flexion and extension down in the lumbar spine. The key difference, though, is really in an area we call the facet joints of the spine. The facet joints are these little joints between the vertebrae above and the vertebrae below, right here. You can see a little bit better on this view where the green and the pink kind of come together. This little joint is called a facet joint. We have one on both sides, and they're synovial joints just like our knee. You can see if we look at the intersection between the T11 and the T12 vertebrae, the orientation of that facet joint is a little bit more in what we would call the frontal plane, meaning it kind of runs this way across the back. But then as we come down to the junction between the 12th thoracic vertebrae and the first lumbar, now those facet joints, instead of facing like this, have turned to face this way. So when they're facing this way, that's more flexion extension as opposed to above it when they're facing more outward. So because of that transition, this is part of why this area in the spine is so naturally weak and predisposed to fractures. Now, for Knox to have had a dislocation on top of the fracture, that means that these facet joints here in the spine became dislocated. We don't know specifically where the fracture was in these vertebral bodies, but it was severe enough that the combination of the fracture and that excessive extension causes these facet joints to become completely dislocated to where those vertebral bodies are now no longer lined up with one another. Now, Knox was very fortunate to have not suffered complete paralysis from this injury. I've got the spinal cord here, and the spinal cord, of course, runs inside the hole or the spinal canal between these vertebral bodies. So if you take one and you completely dislocate it, you can imagine how easy it's gonna be to shear and damage the spinal cord running between it. He had some nerve damage, but he wasn't completely paralyzed. And there's some thought for how that's possible to happen when people have fracture dislocations. Likely what happens is that you lose basically this whole posterior portion of the vertebrae comes completely off, to where even though it's dislocated, you still have a good amount of space for the spine to move in that spinal column, to where it might get a little bit bruised, but it's not gonna become completely transected or torn to result in complete paralysis. Even if Knox would have had a spinal cord injury, it would not have affected his arms based on this anatomy. All the nerves that control the function of our arms are up here in the cervical spine, much, much higher up than where his injury was. So when you have a spinal cord injury, it's at and around that level of injury and everything below it that can become damaged. So the control and sensation of the legs, the bowel, the bladder, all come from this lumbar and sacral levels. And so if this would have been an injury at that level, then we would have worried about weakness and paralysis of his legs. Similar to what we saw with Ryan Shazier, again, an injury in his low back that caused some paralysis of his leg muscles. Johnny Knox is very fortunate to have not had a catastrophic outcome from this injury. Really, by pure chance, his spinal cord wasn't put in a position where it was severely injured. And so even though this injury did ultimately lead to his retirement from football, he is still very fortunate. That's it for the video, everybody. Again, thank you to glassesusa.com for sponsoring this video. Be sure and go check out the link below to learn more and check out all the great offerings that they have, including that really cool virtual try-on tool. Let me know any questions or comments down below. And until next time, we'll see you later. Bye.